funding railroad is always going to be a challenge, even though there's a contractual obligation there to do that by both states, getting the people and the parties to realize that they do have ownership in the railroad is still an educational challenge that we seem to have to fight every year, that they do own the railroad. A lot of people, just, at least in Colorado, at our state level, will not as familiar with the railroad than we need them to be, so. Anyway, so things are looking incredibly well for Colorado.
Keep our fingers crossed.
And the other thing I wanted to reference, you know, originally started out the funding that we got from both states for repair of the trestle was absolutely invaluable to maintaining the railroad running. It's interesting, their funds were less because of the recession, but because the federal government kicked in ARRA money, that absolutely saved us. I can't think, if we had to have a crisis, it happened during the 1 year that there was federal funding available, and that's what, I know Colorado and I believe New Mexico used some of those funds to go to the railroad, which went to the trestle. So if this would have happened a year later, we'd be having a whole different story. So we're incredibly lucky in the timing that there's money available exactly the year that we needed it.
Was it
a year before or a year after?
Yeah, actually, Marvin really feels lucky.
Actually, New Mexico's was not our
wasn't.
Yeah, no, it's federal highway.
And then the last thing, there's a lot of people behind the scenes that you guys probably don't get to meet. One of them was a lady named Elisa Esgar. She was a deputy in the budget department there. She has been such a strong proponent of the railroad. Unfortunately, when the change in people here, she's no longer at the Capitol, but she absolutely somehow got a lot of the money in the budget and pushed that behind the scenes. So she's now working, I think, for the University of Colorado. She's no longer at the state level, so we're working on developing a relationship with the new budget director, which is named Sorbonnet, we've established that contact already, but I don't think Hickenlooper could have picked a better person for Colorado at the given the time it's in. This guy is very brilliant, so he now knows the railroad is an obligation. Yeah, so it's good to have a new thing, but Lisa Esgar was an absolute gem that we had behind the scenes pulling for us from the state level, so did a lot of the education for us.
Yes.
We did give her the commission donated a 40th anniversary poster, which we give her in appreciation for her work on that once she was announced that she was leaving the office, so.
Yeah, we had that one conference call about the engineering, and the next day she turned around and let go some money for us to pay for engineering and the move.
Yep.
The locomotive, so that's how responsive she was.
So then we got her down here one day, and I took her up to the trestle, or John and I took her to the trestle, and she was watching Marvin cut the coupon out of the side of the trestle, and a while later is when she found the $480,000 for us.
Yeah.
So she was here the first time. Yeah.
Developing relationships, absolutely vital. And you'll have to keep doing that, especially in the political arena. Absolutely vital.
Okay.
Okay. At this point, I'll open up for public comment.
Thank you. Good to see you.
Pardon me?
It's about war and everything else.
Oh, okay.
Jeez. Thanks, man.
Right. If anybody has any public comments, you need to give us your name for the record. So. Jeez. This is James.
I'm Austin Johnson.
What, Bob?
Thing that is Council. It's an unusual name.
How do you spell that, Bob? I'm sorry.
I didn't know what you said.
S-A-L-L.
Okay, thank you.
My last name is Johnson. When you were discussing the online reservation service, does that respond to groups? Say if you have 28 seats available and a group of five people want to get seats on it, would they be scattered?
Great question. The management company.
Roger?
Yes, it will. When you say groups, we have two different style groups. We have groups that are coming by the busload. And if you're having a private party and you're requesting, yes, if there's enough seats when you make the request. Now, if you make the request and we only have five seats that are not committed, then the answer is no. It's all according to the prior reservation, so you have a better chance if you reserve early.
But it would put seats together if they were available.
Seats are available, yes.
That was the question.
Yes.
And the system now is so easy to use and quick that if you see you can't get the five together, you can actually, you have the option to pick another date. I mean, if that's your only date, then we can hopefully accommodate it, you know, that when you get there. But you'll see that you can quickly go to another date and see if there's five in the group.
Or another car that same day.
Right.
That's in the nature of my question, yeah.
Yes.
But as a docent, I've been on the train, you know, people who found themselves scattered in the car, and then we can generally get people to trade seats, but the reservations encourages them to be grouped to be happier.
Good question. Thank you for being a docent on the train. Appreciate your time. Okay, hearing. Go ahead. Your name, please?
Zach Blaya from Chama.
Okay.
To further back up, please, my concern with the reservation system was would it coagulate with the individual cars? So I don't know how many times last year we had a problem where the system said one car would be a 44-seater, but we'd end up having people book for the restroom. Of course, it was easy to sell, we just have them move up to another car. But would the system recognize individual cars in the train, or?
Yes.
So that's an improvement, I take it, over the old system.
Oh, yes.
I like the fact that we're selling them the seat and the rest of them. That's good.
Every seat is paid a seat.
That is a single show.
Absolutely. Pay extra or less.
Same price. Everything's all inclusive.
Okay, Gary, go ahead, Steve, please.
My mail usually doesn't bring me anything positive, but today I picked up a note from Becky Osterwald. That's Doris Osterwald's daughter. Doris Osterwald will turn 90, I think, around April 3rd, and they're having a birthday party for her, and they requested cards or sentiments of, you know, if you can't attend or whatever, so just so you know that, you know, she's made it to 90. Now, she's the lady that wrote Ticket to Toltec, which is our guidebook for the railroad. All right, and she's wrote guidebooks for almost every train in the area. So just thought y'all might want to know that.
Yeah, can we get the permission to send that address out?
Okay.
Okay. All right, hearing nothing else, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
We'll have a quorum left.
I know.
You can adjourn it since we've finished our
meeting. All right. And commission meeting's adjourned. Thank you, everybody, for showing up today.